Starting out in your career is a memorable experience. Often our first foray into paid work can be daunting, exciting, overwhelming, and memorable all at the same time. The world of work is changing, especially for today's school leavers, which is Generation Z. They are entrepreneurial, career mobile, and could have 18 jobs across 6 careers in their lifetime. As Gen Z are the newest generation to enter the workforce, we thought we would explore some advice and tips about how they can stand out in the future of work. And joining me to do that in today's episode is McCrindle's Managing Director, Sophie Renton. Soph, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. As always, delighted to be here.
I thought we could begin by just chatting. Before we get into our advice, maybe we should share a little bit about our maybe first job or first paid work experience. What was yours like, Soph?
Oh, my very first ever paid work experience was posting letters or folding letters into envelopes. So I had a whole system set up though, because you had to stamp them, you had to label them. That was probably when I was about maybe 10 years old when I think about that. But if I think about what my first kind of full-time job experience was like, that was actually quite wild. It all happened quite quickly. I was working a couple of casual jobs before I took it on. So I went for my final interview on the Monday, and the Thursday I started full-time work and had just 2 days crossover with the person before me, 2 days of training, and then I was on my own. And it was very much, here are the outcomes. You can make up your own process to achieve them. So it was pretty full on, but I loved it.
Yeah, I feel like most people would remember their training experience, like how well you were looked after, because that's a new environment. It's pretty daunting what the crossover was like, how well equipped you feel to actually do the task. I think about mine, and it was a little bit not opposite to yours, but mine was at Virgin Active. So it was part-time when I was at university, but they were opening a brand new health club. And so the training we all got, like all the staff that worked in the club, and I was only casually employed there, was intense. Like it was a week of offsite training, all about customer service and how to like deal with customers, and obviously then role specific things for each of the different departments. But I felt like that was just an incredibly like blessed training experience that not everyone really gets, because it was everyone in the same boat learning about the culture and how to do things. But I mean, we know from our research as well, like training is really important. But another sort of question I was thinking we could maybe share about is any career advice that you've received throughout your life that has stayed with you. Anything come to mind for you, Soph?
Yeah, what comes to mind for me on this one, it was actually quite a freeing piece of advice. And it was an older gentleman. He told me just to back myself. And he said, pretty much everyone is making it up as you go along. And that was actually quite freeing, because I think I had this perspective that there's this point that you arrive in your career or you arrive in your job and you just know what to do in different situations. And yes, there's things that you learn along the way and you do build that wisdom and that experience. But whatever role you're in, there's always challenges and things that you don't know. So everyone is actually in some ways making it up as they go along. And I was like, oh, for someone maybe who had a little bit of imposter syndrome, that was just great to know that there's not this, I guess, level of perfection that everyone else is operating at except for you. So makes the goal a lot more achievable rather than unattainable. But how about you? What advice did you get?
It's similar. I mean, mine's a bit more like an inspirational quote, maybe from that first week of training, because it's from Richard Branson, who is the head of, you know, Virgin Active. But it's this quote that I have kind of drawn back to a few times, and it's very similar to yours in terms of like when you arrive or when you feel ready or when you should step into a new space or an opportunity. And the quote is, if somebody offers you an amazing opportunity but you are not sure you can do it, say yes, then learn how to do it later. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's a bit blunt and a bit scary, but it goes kind of in hand with what you were saying, Soph, is that no one really knows what they're doing. No one ever feels like they've arrived. Everyone is an imposter in some ways. No one really feels like they're 100% qualified already, even really experienced business people. And so I feel like everyone's just winging it, which is comforting when you're just starting out, because you don't want to kind of take yourself out of the running, I think, for new things. Mm-hmm. And just to do them when you're not ready is how we all learn and grow. And I certainly have learnt that in my career. So yeah.
Say yes, freak out later.
Say yes, exactly. And freak out, you know, with your friends over a glass of wine afterwards or something, but just pretend, you know, fake it till you make it kind of vibes. Yeah. So let's think about workplaces of the future and the life and the world that school leavers today are entering. We do a lot of commentary on this around how work is changing and the future of work. How do you think workplaces differ to that of the past? Do you have any sort of examples or things that come to mind in terms of how things have changed with regards to the workplace or how we do work today?
A lot has changed in how we do work and the workplaces of today. However, not all work, the, I guess, management and leadership structures have necessarily caught up with that. The way that we think about productivity and systems is still largely from the industrial era, where it was produce something, make something, have a line, assembly line. Yet for a lot of workers today, it's a lot more of a knowledge economy, a lot more of creativity, a lot more of space. And how do you measure productivity there? So I think that's probably the first shift, that the what we're actually outputting is somewhat different to what it used to be. But I think in terms or along the lines of that, there's also been significant automation. Yes, that's the one. You know, AI, the changes and the shifts, the tech space that is changing at an increasingly accelerated space. And then just throw in that COVID completely upheaved the way that we conducted work. We've got hybrid environments today. We've got changing leadership structures. We've got remote work. There's this need for, I guess, self-awareness and self-management in greater levels than there has been before. And I just think that the whole, I guess, landscape and environment in some ways is getting more complex. And everything naturally trends towards complexity. So a key role of a leader in this time is actually how to keep it simple, how to keep the organization's flow simple, how to keep the onboarding process simple, to bring simplicity back into what is becoming an increasingly complex workplace.
Yeah, there's some really great observations. And I think about that even in terms of even just the sheer fact that we've got different generations mixing in. And I think about sometimes the advice that I've received from people in my life who are older, you know, when you're starting a new job and you're like fresh out of school and everyone around you who's, I mean, like a few years older than you and above is just like, let me impart my life wisdom, which is a great time to like absorb that wisdom from people who you love and respect in your life. But sometimes even just some of the things I remember, as I was starting at work, you know, quite a few years ago now, in terms of like, you can't leave before the boss leaves or that, like, and I feel like sometimes that still has merit today in terms of we want to definitely be working hard and we want to be seen and rewarded for that. But it's so much around like visibility and autocratic leadership. And it's just like, oh, it's so different. Like you mentioned, because now we all need to be more autonomous. And if people are remote working, they need to be working hard still, even though that's not visible, and we've got new work-life balance things to deal with now. So really, yeah, different, and COVID's really sort of thrown up a lot of that. I think as well about particularly those generations, and something that sort of sparked, I guess, the idea for this episode was that we have the privilege oftentimes of sharing advice and keynotes based on research, but we sometimes get to input our own sort of advice and wisdom about the world of work, the future of work, how Generation Z can sort of stand out in it. And I got to deliver a presentation about this at a conference recently, and I started by sharing our content from our most recent education future report about the changes that's happening in the world of work, which you had a very heavy hand in authoring that report, Soph. And one of the things that I talked about, which I know we've mentioned on the podcast before, is almost these tensions that workers today need to navigate, because nothing, I was trying to think, how do I inspire these young people as they start their careers at this conference? And I was like, I want to be realistic, but inspiring at the same time. And the way I wanted to sort of address that was to explore some of the tensions that I feel like I've had to navigate, even just as a millennial in the workplace over the last decade. And some of those tensions that I also see, I think, play out in the research that we advise organizations and leaders and students on, is around the tension between wanting to have and the need to have human skills or traditional like soft skills versus technical skills. Like, it's not just one or the other, it's a combination of both depending on your context. Totally. And depending on your role. Another one I was thinking about was, you want to be a specialist, like there's great merit in being a specialist, but there's also benefits of having sort of generalist skills that you can apply across different industries and sectors. This is an interesting one that I wanted to share with these attendees. I was like, contrary to what I shared earlier, like the tension between saying yes to opportunities and challenging yourself, but also the tension with that to have boundaries in your life and to establish those early. And I've even learned a lot about that from you, Soph, in terms of you're an incredibly hard worker, but you also try as best you can to have boundaries and to look after different aspects of our health with regards to work. The tension between wanting to work with passion and purpose, but also the very real need we all have to earn a living and to save for mortgages or pay those off, whatever that might be. And again, that tension between stepping into new opportunities, like we talked about earlier, but also battling imposter syndrome and feeling like you're trained and equipped. So maybe that just confused a whole lot of people in terms of, you know, it's complex. But I mean, we talk about tensions, and I know that you appreciate that too, Soph. How have you found that in your own experience or the research around some of the tensions that, you know, Gen Z or even all of us today need to face with regards to work?
Yeah, the tensions 100% exist. And I think that's actually the first step, is acknowledging that they exist and realizing that it's not just a simple linear pathway, but it's shades of gray. That's life. There's moments where, you know, you might have a boundary which says I leave at X time, but there's a project that's due that's for a client, for a project that you care about, and you've got to go, well, I need to deliver this. So I need to do what needs to be done to make this happen. And I think it's really important, particularly for, you know, new graduates coming into the workforce, just to be aware even of how business works as a landscape, that business resources are actually finite. You know, your boss doesn't just have buckets of money to do whatever they want. Now, some organizations do, and great for them, but it is, resources are finite. There are tensions even in how business leaders lead businesses. There's not unlimited budgets for everything. And it's navigating those tensions as well as navigating the tensions within, as you said, the intergenerational workforce, understanding the employees that you have around you, learning to bring your best, but putting the boundaries. It's a great learning experience. It's complex, it's challenging, but it's super exciting. And if you find a really good organization, I think if you're going into the workforce for the first time, do what you can to find that organization with a purpose that you align with. Because if you're passionate about your work, the day-to-day comes so much easier.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think as well, as you mentioned there, like, yeah, it's not black and white. And even when we have boundaries in our life, another example in addition to the one you used about working on a project you care about is working with colleagues that you care about. And you see someone who's struggling or buried under a work, and it comes time for you to go home and you can see them and you're like, can I help with anything? And then maybe you stay back a bit longer because you're helping them, or they needed help earlier in the day, which meant your work got pushed out. So, you know, it's always fluid and flexible, and hopefully we're all in workplaces where we do have help and we do have work that we're passionate about. Another tip I shared at this event was about defying generational stereotypes. And we hear this all the time, but I feel like I've heard it even just lately from people in my life. And I feel like they always talk to me because they're like, Ash, you talk about generations, you know about Gen Z and millennials, like how do we engage these young people? And I have heard that a bit, like, oh, young people today don't want to work as hard as previous generations. And I guess there is that sort of old timeless aspect that older generations always think they worked harder than the ones coming through who are a bit younger. How do you think, Soph, Gen Z, let's take Gen Z, you know, the emerging workforce, can challenge maybe some of the stereotypes that they might be met with when they emerge into a new workplace?
I think first up, don't work in such a way that confirms those stereotypes is probably my first piece of advice. Don't come across as lazy. Don't, you know, or flip it, be diligent, be hardworking. Seek to see how you can add value to your colleagues, to the organization. I always think about, how do I leave what has been entrusted to me in a better place than how I found it? How do I lift this? How do I leave it better than how I found it? Because what's happening at the end of the day is your boss or your leader is entrusting a piece of work to you, and you need to do that to the best of your ability. And I think just acknowledging the reputation, like, what is your internal stamp of quality? And for, I know you, Ash, and me, and for many people here at McCrindle, like, our stamp of quality is high. And so know that your name is what is getting put out, and know that your name and your reputation is being built in every single little action you do. It takes years to build your reputation, but you can honestly lose it in a moment. And so I think, yeah, work in a way that actually doesn't confirm those stereotypes. Be hardworking, be diligent. When I think about raising up future leaders, even within our organization, and we've often talked about this, but one of the qualities that we look for is that humility. Be willing to work your way up. Never be too big for something, but be willing to do whatever needs to be done. And particularly when you're first starting out, it's an opportunity to learn. Say yes to everything. Try new things. Learn what you like, what you don't like, and bring value to the people around you. Because if you are working hard, bringing value, and being humble and willing to do what's in your hand to do and leaving it in a better place than how you found it, you are going to break those stereotypes.
Yeah, totally. I think there was so much wisdom in that. I love what you were saying about everything you do builds your reputation. And even when you're entrusted with really small things, like people aren't going to entrust you with bigger things if they can't trust you with the small things. Mm-hmm. And maybe those menial tasks that we don't think are important. But yeah, and that can be, you know, I remember, like, for me early on, there were things that I didn't love about my job that maybe were incredibly highly administrative, but I was like, well, actually, I really like administrative things anyway, but like the organizer in me is like, yeah, let's get this done. Like, let's tick all these things off. But I think about people who I've worked with or who I've led in my teams over my career, and it makes me, when they are entrusted and they handle those maybe perceivingly menial tasks or little things, that makes me want to give them more opportunities, like when they are humble, when they do, you know, don't consider any task beneath them. And something else I think can almost play into maybe like young people's favor with regards to the generational stereotype is that maybe there is a low expectation of you, which actually almost in some ways makes it easy to exceed. Like, why don't you come in if they think, oh, Gen Z are lazy or Gen Z are entitled or they don't want to do these tasks, come in and prove them wrong. Like, it's actually a cool moment when you go, okay, this is going to motivate me to actually do good work. And like you said, and I know that you use this phrase a lot, and I can see why, like when you're, whatever you're entrusted with to do that well and to steward that well. So if we can flip it on its head and use it for our benefit, that's great.
Totally. And I love, like, half of our team here is Gen Z and they are amazing. Like, honestly, the ideas they bring, I love that they want a voice at the table and I love that they're bringing their ideas, they're seeing solutions, but I love it when it's packaged in an understanding or a way that goes like, this is a thought, but do with it what you will. And I think that's the really beautiful thing that makes it work, because there is a recognition that you're early on in your career, and that's not to stifle that creativity, and that's not to stifle those ideas, because it's so important, because you're starting out, you're seeing all the things we're doing wrong because you've got fresh ideas and we want that. And I think it's learning the way to communicate that well also helps to not bring across this entitled perspective. Whereas if you're day one coming in and saying, you're doing everything wrong, like, here is my grand plan of how to fix everything, you know, that's not necessarily going to win people to your favor straight away. So I think have a bit of wisdom in how you challenge things, but still back yourself to challenge things, because that is really important as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, we're giving a lot of advice here to Gen Z, who are, you know, admittedly young and starting out their careers and don't have a whole lot of experience. But I think it should also be said too that it's not just younger generations that can, you know, challenge the stereotype, but maybe it also needs to be older generations in the workplace who maybe need to check themselves, maybe we should say check ourselves with regards to the stereotypes that they hold or that we hold. I mean, there's got to be a little bit of onus on the older generations too, perhaps, maybe.
100%. Healthy intergenerational workplaces are ones where everyone can choose to see the strengths of a generation that is not their own, where they can see those that are younger or those that are older and see the strengths that they bring to the table. I think if there are any more mature age listeners today, I would just say give young people a chance to prove themselves, because as I reflect on my career, I am so grateful for leaders who took a chance on me. And I really didn't want to let them down, and I worked really hard to honor the chance that they had given me, because I think as younger people, we need to be aware that many times when they're giving us those opportunities, what they're actually doing is putting their reputation on the line to give you a chance.
So true. Yeah.
And we need to honor that because if that doesn't go to plan, a good leader won't actually let it get to you. They'll take that heat themselves. But if it goes well, then they'll pass that on. And I've had leaders that have stood up for me when I haven't done great. And that has meant that I have trusted them and I have backed them and I have done whatever I could for them because they believed in me and gave me a chance. And so I think as, if we've got older listeners today, give young people a chance, mentor them through that process, give them a chance to fail, but don't shy away from that opportunity to grow with them and to give them feedback. And then younger people, totally give our older workers the honor that is deserved by them entrusting their reputation to you. And I think for all generations, it's so important just to understand maybe what things are generational. Like I think back and I remember I used to work in a high school and we were on this trip and I was working with a more senior member on our team. And they really wanted to make this big deal about like a charitable gift that was being done. And so they wanted to have this ceremony to like shake the hand. And I'm like, what the heck? Why does this matter? Just give them the money and move on. But yeah. I had to stop myself and go, you know what? Maybe 30 years ago, that was actually quite the done thing. And there was a moment to be made out of that. So why don't I just temper back my perspective for a moment and go, that's actually important to them. How can I help them in that? Regardless of maybe what I think about this. Now, that's such a small example, but I think there is a self-awareness and I think there's some empathy that we can all bring to the equation to take a step back and go, actually, what lens are people looking through and how do I understand it from their perspective?
Yeah, wow. There's so much wisdom in that answer. I'm trying to figure out what to pull out. Like I love that, like even just the leadership advice you were sharing there around like, yeah, great leaders entrust and equip and encourage the people they're leading, but then they actually often don't let them take the blame when things don't work out. They step in and they do that because that's their role as a leader. They don't just go, oh, that's not my fault. That wasn't me who made X, Y decision or whatever. But yeah, and then I totally agree in terms of the empathy that all of us need to have when we're working with people who have different experiences or life stages or even different ages to us in terms of going, okay, yeah, this isn't how I would do it. I don't see the relevance anymore of whatever we're talking about, like for you and your story, that sort of ceremony, but acknowledging that, yeah, that was something that was important to them and giving them the space to do that. If it doesn't really matter, like if it's not a big business decision, but it's going to have good impacts regardless. So yeah, I think so many things I even took out from that answer. So thank you. And I wanted to share some great advice that actually I was looking it up. So it came originally from Sheryl Sandberg, who I'm pretty sure is still the COO at Facebook. And I've read her book Lean In, which was really, really great. And it was great book. And it was shared through one of our previous guests, Shelley Johnson, on the podcast, on the Future Report podcast, about careers being jungle gyms, not ladders. And I included that in this presentation because I think it's helpful, even, you know, not even just for anyone starting out in their career, but for anyone working today. Like even for me, I was like, that's a great way to think about it because careers today aren't linear. Maybe they never even have been, but we've just had this perception, like the ladder probably sort of analogy or metaphor, just that you've got to keep going up the rung and keep climbing versus the jungle gym, which has got different paths and then it's got a slide and then it's got a ball pit and then it's got a rest, you know, station.
Sounds a lot more fun.
Yeah, it absolutely does. And I think it's a great sort of metaphor there because even if someone listening to this didn't get into the career they wanted or the career path or the degree or the job, they didn't get that particular job, you know, that's okay. That's part of building your resilience, which might help you further down the track. And you talk to anyone and their career is not probably where even they thought they would be or have ended up, or the path they got there has not been sort of that step-by-step. And it's okay if you take a break or do something extra or have a different experience. I think if anything, the message is about not letting those setbacks discourage you. Or the other thing is to stop your momentum. And I remember when we were writing the Generation Alpha book, Mark and I were putting down some ideas and thoughts about like career advice for young people. And one of the things he was sharing was some research that was conducted that momentum plays a really important part in your career in terms of, especially when you're starting out. And I guess that's the concern with some people taking gap years, and I'm all for gap years. I'm not saying they're a bad idea, but it's more about if you've got something maybe planned or an idea or a goal, rather than just losing that momentum, like when you finish school and going, oh, I'll just take a massive break. But then it's so easy to lose that momentum with regards to work. So anyway, with regards to this sort of career linear pathway, Soph, do you agree with that advice that it's maybe helpful, or have you seen it even play out in your own life or career?
Yeah, I love this piece of advice. I think what it does is it takes the pressure off. It takes the pressure that you need to have one step that leads to this next step up, and that you're constantly progressing, and you know what, you're leading an organization by the time you're 25. Like, we've almost narrowed down far too much what's expected in those first few years of working life. It's no longer a midlife crisis. That's like the quarter life crisis. It's like, okay, let's just take a step back, take the pressure off, and walk through the doors that open. I think that's what I have found, is that I have walked through doors that I wasn't quite sure where they would lead, but they have actually led me to be where I am now. And each part of your journey actually prepares you for what you're doing next. Like you, I have the privilege of speaking on platforms of influence and you know, sharing with people around key trends. And that does take, I guess, a level of public speaking and communication. And as I reflect on my journey, working in a high school for 7.5 years, I would actually say prepared me for what I do now, because I used to have to do it 2:30 on a Friday afternoon at an assembly with high school students, you know, share some thoughts and hold their attention for about 20 minutes, which anyone who's worked in a high school knows that that is like the toughest gig on the planet on a Friday afternoon.
Any audience compared to that? Easy. Yeah.
Exactly. If I can learn how to keep students' attention on a Friday afternoon, what I'm doing there is I'm actually learning the craft of speaking. Mm. And those hidden years, as such, you could say prepared me for what I'm doing now. Mm. But I would never have known that back then. Mm. And I think it's so important to, once again, be faithful with what's been entrusted to you. Do your best at every situation. Even if you don't love it, learn from it, because those are the things that actually prepare you with skills and talents for the next season. So I love that piece of advice. It's a jungle gym. It's not linear. Go through the doors that are open. Follow what you're passionate about. Follow what you love. And you actually find yourself stepping into some really great opportunities and situations. Would you say that that's true of you?
Yeah, totally. And yes, similar, you know, when people ask about something that both you and I do a lot at McCrindle is public speaking and professional speaking, and people are like, oh, have you got a background in this? And I guess it's easy to be like, not really. And then you go, hang on, I do. I've been in roles in the past that have required me to get up and deliver a talk, or I did debating at school or singing. And those things that you're like, actually, those things have made me comfortable in front of an audience. They've made me think about how to communicate an engaging message verbally, those sorts of things. So yeah, I definitely think that's true. And even that you mentioned about like those skills that are transferable, we know that that's really important for the future of work, which is in some ways unknown. Like, we're futurists and we're acknowledging that the future of work in 10, 15, 20 years is going to look very different to today. We might not know exactly what it will look like, even though we've got some fun sort of like futurist jobs that we often talk about and pitch to people in terms of, yeah, could you be a drone operator in the future? Like, you know, these really futuristic jobs. But it's often, yeah, even in where you are today, it's learning skills that you might not even be where you're learning that will prepare you for the tasks that you will be entrusted with in the future. So definitely agree with that, and found that comforting for even myself as I think about like my past career journey and even looking to the future. So hopefully a school leaver today can take comfort in that rather than, you know, take on all that pressure. Because we know young people today have a lot of pressure put on them, maybe by themselves, maybe by their families, maybe by their schools or the media. So understanding that there's lots of different ways you can get to where you want to go, if you know where you want to go. Because a lot of people don't know where they want to go, and that's okay too.
Totally.
Yeah. Another tip I gave, and I wanted to just talk about this a little bit, because I think, you know, it's really important for anyone to have boundaries with regards to their work. We know that, and even prior to COVID, like burnout was a real issue. A lot of people were sort of saying even to the ABS time use study that only has just been released again, that they were often rushed or pressed for time, that work was a key part of stress that would impede on their sleep. Like that's when work is not contributing to our well-being. And yes, there's always going to be times that maybe are a bit more stressful or work plays in our minds, which is normal. But part of the reason I talked about establishing good work well-being habits when you're young and practicing is because A, I believe in it, but B, I also wanted to sort of address and be relevant to a trend that has been doing the rounds around sort of quiet quitting. And just to be aware that Generation Z, there's a lot of content and encouragement about having those boundaries and, you know, making sure that companies aren't taking advantage of you. And it's like, yes, I believe that. But also we've acknowledged that there will be times where extra discretionary effort is required, and that's often rewarded and hopefully acknowledged by the places that people are employed. So I guess, you know, that's a bit of a background as to why I included that work well-being. So how do you think Gen Z or anyone starting out a new job or career can establish good work well-being habits? Because again, I look to you as a leader in this space, because you, and no one's perfect at it, but I know that you have those boundaries in place for yourself. And as a leader of our organization and someone who sets the culture, I know that you have that task as well of looking after people in our team around their work well-being. So any reflections or advice for someone starting out in their career around work well-being / quiet quitting / just boundaries in general?
Well, that's a loaded question. There's a lot in there. I'll start with boundaries.
Pick out what you want to talk about. It's totally fine.
Yeah, I'll start with boundaries because I think that is the place that we start when we talk about well-being. Mm. And I think it's so important to know what is important to you in life and in work. And we need that self-awareness and that self-management to know what we need to stay healthy. So in terms of practical things, a couple of things that I do is I'm a morning person. So I actually make sure that I do the things that I need to stay healthy. I do them in the morning before I even set foot into the office, whether that's going to the gym, whether that's, you know, time and space for reflection. I know that once I go into the office, the day starts, the hustle and bustle. I might not get out on time because someone needs something from me just when I'm going to leave. So I make sure that I do that first. And that means that I'm always in a healthy space that I can actually bring something to the table to give to others. Because if I'm not looking after myself and I'm depleted, I've actually got nothing to offer and I'm not helping anybody. So it's so important to look after yourself. But I think the motive needs to be checked. We possibly have swung the pendulum a little bit too far that I'm looking after myself because I am the only person in this world that matters, but it's actually looking after yourself so that you have something to contribute also for yourself, but that motive is actually, I think, needs to come in with service to others first, that when you are healthy, you can bring something to contribute. The things I need, I do those first. Also, I am an absolute stickler for not checking my emails on the weekend. I walk out the door when I finish work and it's done. And the thing is, the team actually knows that. People don't call me on the weekend. They don't call me on holiday. They don't believe I'm going to check an email on holiday because I've been quite firm on that boundary. And I think that's really helpful when you can actually explain what your boundaries are or what your ideal is to others. So the communication aspect, I think, is really important. And probably just the last thing I would say on boundaries is actually to talk about just being present. That when I'm at work, I am fully present at work. I'm not doing things that are for myself on the side, but the same goes that once I leave the office, I am fully present with my family, with my friends. And I actually think we waste so much time by simply being halfway present in so many moments of our lives. And that actually helps us do boundaries well, that if we go, I'm at work and I'm going to accomplish these tasks, then you know what? I'm here, I'm going to smash those out. And then when the time comes, I'm going to close that laptop and say, job well done. Whereas if you half bake things the whole way through, you kind of don't feel like you've done anything well. And that's what I've found has worked for me. I would do want to acknowledge, I guess, that quiet quitting or the flip side of all of this, that we do need to acknowledge that there are times to go above and beyond, and don't be so ruthless on these boundaries that we're never actually willing to let a bit of self-sacrifice in to help others and to contribute to the cause that's bigger than ourselves. So I think boundaries are really good when we think of them as indicators more so than rules, that it's like, okay, my boundary is typically this. Now there's a bit of gray, there's a little bit of times when the pendulum might swing, but if it swings too far, then I know I need to address this and bring this back. And so it's better as an indicator that maybe things are out of whack rather than a full hard and fast and I am never going to stay past 5 o'clock, at 5:01 I'm out. Because I think you do need to give that little bit more, or you need to respond to the situation. I don't know. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, the quiet quitting, totally. I agree with everything you said, firstly, and I think the tips you gave are incredibly practical and really helpful. So thank you for sharing those and for living those out. I think as well, yeah, with quiet quitting, like I guess on the surface, it's good in some ways that this generation are like, okay, we're recognizing that boundaries are important and that, you know, work and life are a balance. But like you said, it's a tension to hold. There'll be times where it goes one way and you go, okay, it's a busy week. I'm aware of that. I might need to put in a little bit of extra work to get the work done, to have those great impacts, to help people in my team because it's a team effort, whatever that is. And there are other times where maybe, you know, you've got things going on outside of life that you do need to have those boundaries for and to prioritize, which is a good and healthy practice to have. I think the other thing about quiet quitting, and this is maybe a bit of advice for people who think they themselves are quiet quitting, or who, if you're a leader and you think people in your team are quiet quitting, like I guess the difference is between like whether people are drawing boundaries, but they're still engaged and motivated by the work they do, or if people are quiet quitting in an organization where it's a really unhealthy team culture and there are unrealistic expectations and they've just kind of like mentally checked out. So that might be another distinguish to make in terms of for yourself, in terms of if you feel like you're going, oh, I never want to go above and beyond here, whether that's a great workplace for you actually to be in, if you can thrive here, if you can feel like you can contribute. So yeah, it's tension because it's both. You want to maybe be motivated enough to do extra work, but also to be in a workplace that goes, we don't expect you to be working in the evenings and working on the weekends. We want you to have a thriving life outside of work. So that tension again kind of comes into it, I think.
Yeah, definitely. Back that, all of that.
And I guess even a part of that, as I mentioned, there is around the workplace culture, and we've talked a lot about that and just the importance and the weight that culture plays in sort of attracting great team members but also retaining them and having a great sort of motivation for coming to work and being part of a team and having fun while getting work done and having great impacts. I think as we think about the future, we're talking about Generation Z who are emerging in the workforce, but it won't be long before they start taking up leadership roles if they say yes to those opportunities. So I feel like it's an interesting tension. I think even for me when I was, you know, in my, say, early 20s, early on in my career, it's like I want to be a leader. Maybe one day I've got that drive or that ambition, but I don't have the role, the title yet. I guess as we think about the future for this youngest generation, these early years, like you said, you know, it's a time to build your reputation, a time to build your skills and even your ability to contribute to the workplace and have influence even without that title. Do you have any advice, Soph, as we think about the future for Generation Z, about how those, you know, newer to the workforce can become leaders now, even without, say, the formal title for the sake of their future careers?
A piece of advice comes to mind from a leader in my world, and he simply says, if you are too big to serve, you are too small to lead. And I love that because it comes back to that element of humility, that start out, do whatever is in your hand to do. Take the opportunity to learn from every single moment. Learn from those that have gone before you. You don't need to make the same mistakes. Ask some questions. So often those in leadership or those that are older are actually willing to pass on that advice if you'll just ask the question. Be willing to help those in leadership and build that relationship with them, because you never know what doors will open to you. I think be up for the challenge and know that you're actually a culture contributor right where you are, and you can choose to build that culture. You can choose to actually lead, because leadership is influence, and you can invest in culture without even having a title. So yeah, humility, be culture contributors, be solutions orientated, and do whatever you can to further the cause of the organization and to serve your colleagues around you.
Absolutely. Such great advice. And it reminds me of the episode we recorded with Mark a little while ago around the future of leadership, and we as we were thinking about the future of leadership, we were also kind of taking a look back and how in history leadership has been about the title or authority or brawn. But like you mentioned, now sort of the leadership theory has changed, that it's about influence, it's not about authority. And even like you said, even if you don't hold a leadership role, so to speak, or a leadership title, you can still be someone that influences others. You can still contribute to the culture. And again, people are observing you. Your leaders, if you're not a formal leader, the leaders that you report to are probably watching, and they're thinking about you and your future and your career and your capacity to be in a formal leadership role. So again, not to put a lot of pressure on, but to maybe, like you said, take those opportunities and step up. And it, again, it's almost like counterintuitive, but by like stepping up can often look like doing the humble roles and doing them well, as to what's been asked of you. And then you often get opportunities off the back of that. Well, that's been my experience and a lot of people I know's experience as well. So, yeah. Oh, such good insights. So much wisdom from you today, Soph, on the podcast. Thank you so much for leading our team so well, for sharing so much of your wisdom in a lot of your presentations and reports that you author here, but also on the podcast today.
Oh, thanks. I always love coming on for a chat.
We will absolutely have you on very soon again, I'm sure. And if people would like to stay up to date with some of that research I just mentioned that Soph and our broader team are very involved with, you can keep up to date with McCrindle's latest insights by subscribing to the podcast, following us on social media, or if you want to delve deeper into some of those studies we even sort of cross-referenced today, head to McCrindle.com for that. But as always, thank you for listening to this episode of The Future Report, and bye for now.